We're good to go. So start.
Okay.
And funny. Try now, Bunny.
What?
There we go.
Hello.
Hi.
We can hear you now. Introduce yourself.
I'm Bunny.
Or you can read the donation now. We have a donation.
All right. So we have a donation from Adams. Why do you guys only have $17? You should at least have $34. Thank you for the donation, Adam.
Alright, I guess, am I good to start? Who's on timer?
Yeah, just count me on when you're ready.
Will do. Thank you, Vash. Alright, so I'm Taraj42, and this is Mega Man Battle Network 1. The run uses a lot of RNG manipulation, so there's a lot of times where I'll have to focus on precise movement or folder edits. I'll explain them as we come to them. So, let's just get right to it. I'll start in 3, 2, 1, go. This is Battle Network 1. It's a Mega Man game, but not like the classics. There's no platforming here, it's more of an action RPG. And you'll see, once we get to the tutorial, the combat system is very different. I'm going to start off doing a folder edit right here. There we are. And then I save reset, because the way that RNG works in this game is whenever you do a soft reset, the RNG starts counting from the beginning again. And so we can predict what the value is going to be. And then with some precise setups, we can manipulate pretty much any of the random elements in the game. Random encounters, chip draws, etc. This is the tutorial. So you can see that the way combat works in this game is it takes place on this grid. And you've got a 3x3, and the enemy has a 3x3. And then you start with a selection of 5 of these battleships. You have a deck of 30, and it picks 5 at random. And in the tutorial, the first two fights are fixed. The first one gives you 2 cannons, this one gives you steel, which gives you more area. So there's like utility chips and wide sword. Now I'm gonna get this guy down to 17 health, and that's because that puts RNG in a better spot for the third fight, so that when I finish this guy off, we hold start. Let's see. Aha! And we got 3 cannons. So the third fight actually gives you random chips, but through the RNG manipulation in a very specific second fight, we're able to manipulate 3 cannons and take the third tutorial fight out very quickly. And this is, so this game came out, what, 96? Or wait, no, later than that, 2000? A long time ago. And it's kind of neat. They tried to imagine what society would be like sort of in the future. You've got interconnected network. You've got all these smart devices. Like, your home was being virus scanned right there. Some standard maintenance. And the internet has a bunch of floating E's in the background. This is the future. So right here I'm manipulating a random encounter. I want to get this encounter with the fishy, because if you get a double kill, depending on your performance in battle, you get different ranks. That's busting level S. So you delete viruses, that's called virus busting. And you get a rank between 1 and S, S being the best, and that gives me the dash G chip, something useful I need. But here we're going to intentionally get a low rank, when I shoot the buster 6 times and get hit twice, that'll get me rank 5, and I'll get Mechguard G. So, dash G, Mechguard G. Battleships have a code, and you can only take ships of the same type, or that have the same code. So it's important to have, like, a lot of the same code in your folder, for better folder flow. It's not too important, since we can use RNG manipulation to get only the ships we want. But there are certain other... Oh, wait. So the movement is very particular. I needed to start out holding down left instead of left. What basically happens is every time you change direction, Mega Man stands still for one frame. 1, 2, 3. And this allows RNG to advance. Every time you change direction, Mega Man will stand still, but the RNG advances every frame. So it's a way that you can advance the RNG by one, allowing you to get around different random encounters and get fights on the values that you want. So that was for another Mechguard G. So we have two Mechguard Gs and one Dash G. And now, so the house was being virus scanned earlier, but for whatever reason our oven caught on fire, and their first thought is, well, it's probably a virus, so we're gonna have Mega Man go do some virus checks. Yeah. I'm gonna run over here to good guy Mr. Frog. All those green programs are what operates the oven. We're gonna do two buster shots and fire the cannon. This time we want to do it quickly, so instead of a Mechguard, we get Shockwave K. Shockwave is a useful chip we'll be making a lot of use of in the next scenario. And then I'm just going to run over here, pause well for that turn, and talk to this guy. Poor Mr. Frog's been beat up from all the heat. He gives us the Ice Block program, which is what the oven uses to cool itself down, apparently. And we're going to walk, not run, so that we can dodge some more random encounters. Fortunately, the oven starts to explode, knocks Mega Man out. So Lan, of course, being the smart kid he is going to go grab his water gun to help suppress the electrical fire. There we go. I think you guys need to do something about Discord. I'm just gonna minimize that. Alright. Alright, and we're gonna manipulate another specific fight right here. And get two cannons. This is very quick, so... You have to buffer the cannon usage, and I should get Fire Tower good. If you're too slow, you get Zenny instead and have to redo that fight. But now that we've put out enough of the fire, we can get to the boss at the end, and unsurprisingly, it is Fireman. But unfortunately for him, we can RNG manipulate boss fights as well as anything else. I swung too soon. Alright. Missed the sword. So I'm gonna fire one buster shot, step forward, swing the wide sword, he's gonna move down, hit him with the sword. One more. And he's dead. So, I swung too early on that first one, so... Missed the sword. Alright. But that's the first scenario. It's pretty quick. And now that everything's under control, we can move on to the next day. Lan is a fifth grader, so we're gonna go to school. Unfortunately, he's late as usual. So we're gonna sneak into the back of the classroom and then tiptoe our way to the front, undetected. And talk to all the classmates. They give you tips about constructing your folder and other stuff, as well as setting the scene for the next scenario. And then here we've got our substitute teacher, Mr. Higsby. Shoutouts to his hair. Go talk to Dex. And so the World 3 is the evil organization here, and they're have taken over the school and are running a brainwashing program trying to corrupt the youth and turn them into future World 3 servants. Alright. And another folder edit right there. We're moving chips around as much more than we are adding chips because we draw very specific slots. Like here I'm going to get slot 29, which has a shockwave, and this is the Flappy Virus. It's got 60 health, shockwave does 60 damage. We're going to be making a lot of use of this chip because we want to pick up Quake 1A. So I wiggled one too many times there. Basically, going back to the precise movement, every time you change direction, if you need to kill two frames, you can turn away from where you're going and then back to it. We call that one wiggle. It advances RNG by two, but doesn't change the direction you're moving. Same thing on ramps. So I needed to do five wiggles, I accidentally did six. Yeah. And then two buster shots and the shockwave. Allow me to pick up a second Quake 1A. We'll be collecting four throughout this dungeon. So the gimmick here is there are a bunch of these password protected doors, and some of them are questions like, how many desks are in class 5B? So it's 9. Oops. And it puts you in control of land, so basically you explore the real world as Lion to help Mega Man solve problems in the digital world. And the two sort of parallel themselves, and whenever you unlock one of these doors on the net, it unlocks one of the doors in the real world. So I thought that was a pretty neat overlap and combination of the mechanics. The five movements there are just for timing, because the movement takes the same number of frames, so rather than moving straight to the top left and just trying to time it, you can use the movement to guarantee you always use the shockwave at the right moment. Now, some of the passwords are the same, but some are random, like this one. So it can be any number up to 99, and we just have a pattern for guessing. So that one was 70. 70 takes 6 guesses? 5 or 6? If you take 7 guesses, the password changes. So we've got a pattern to get it in 6 or less. And that's 15. So there are 3 that are fixed, the rest are random. And for this fight, I'm going to wait for the cannon to lock onto me, step forward, fire two buster shots, and then use the shockwave. That's to get the fourth Quake 1A. And then here, this is neat. Mega Man gets locked up right there. He says he's in the AV classroom, so if you get on here and you can see, this is the AV room. And then there's a cutscene here where Mr. Higsby's leaving. You go to the desk, and you restart the computer, and then that fixes Mega Man. So I thought that's pretty neat. And then this is another random door, so we're going to start out with 43. It says it's too low, so we'll go up. Too high, another 70. 79. Alright. Now we do another folder edit. And we put in the 4 quakes that we collected. They'll come in handy in the next fight. But to get past the final door, we need to have a teacher ID. So, now that we've got access to most of the school, we're gonna go try and find our teacher who's gone missing. And she's been tied up in the storage closet. says that Higsby has locked himself in the teacher's lounge and has taken over the school server. So now that she gives us her ID, we can go to the teacher's lounge. No. And I need to do one final save reset here for RNG manipulation. Too high. Alright, first digit's too high. 60. Alright. So now I'm waiting for a visual cue in the background. So if you look, you can see the numbers are changing. I need to push A on a 10 frame window at the next one cycle. So that should be good. And I drew three quakes. Good. So this is the chip that we collected several of. And it's because Number Man likes to hide in the back, unlike Fireman, so we can't get him to come to the front, but the quakes allow him to hit him for a lot of damage even though he's in the back row. We also picked up Fire Tower earlier, so four quakes, a cannon, and Fire Tower is just enough to defeat Number Man. So he's a pretty annoying boss, and we had a hard time coming up with a way to defeat him. Quake ended up being the best option there. If you watch the task, it's kind of neat. He actually gets two area grabs and uses swords on them to get real close. Well, that takes care of scenario number two. So now school's over and we're gonna go onto the net. First we're gonna drop by our friend's house. Pretty much every electronic device has a subcomp that you can go check out and find mystery data and various items in it, as well as different random encounters. So here's a spooky ghost virus, and they move about randomly, except we know that he's going to move up and then down, so we can throw the shockwave and then trick him into jumping onto it and pick up an invis chip. And we're going to go pick up the screen mystery data and get a Rico 50L. Because what we want to do right now is go visit our dad at Scilab, but when we go to the Metro, which opened today, and you talk to this guy, he says that you're unable to buy tickets because something's wrong with the Metro network. So we're going to go figure out what it is, but in order to get there, we have to go talk to our friend Dex. Right, first we got to do a folder edit. There we are. And then there's an audio cue here for this one. We got three quakes and a cannon. Now I need to do 10 buster shots. Three quakes, 10 buster shots. He's going to have 120 health left, and we'll hit him with two cannons. Or three cannons. Okay. So that was a really good Gutsman fight. And now that we beat Gutsman, Dex gave us his access link so we can go deeper onto the internet. Because for whatever reason, he's got the passcode to the second section of the internet. So now we're going to go back home, and this is Internet Area 1. You've seen it before. And the neat thing is, we can do the same thing we did on our first visit, because we want to pick up another Dash G. And so we can just do the same RNG manipulation. One buster shot to advanced RNG, and then wide sword for the double kill. Let me get this fight again. Only instead of a mini bomb, we now have a shockwave. So we're going to do five buster shots and get hit twice. It ends up being the same result, but I did it too quickly. So if you defeat the virus in under 5 seconds, you get an extra rank, so I got rank 6 instead of rank 5, so I got Mechguard A instead of Mechguard G. So I need to redo that fight. The last time I saved was back here. Well, that's okay. Not too big of a time loss. And that time I didn't get hit. Sorry about that. Internet Area 1 has gone through the most revisions, and I'm just mixing up the different encounters. You have a lot of control, but it's also very precise. So, I need to do, let's get it right this time. 5 buster shots, and then get hit twice, and then you shuffle. So that's what we're supposed to do, but we got it now. So get Mechguard G, and now I need to do 3 additional turns. And turn up. And now we're in Internet Area 2. And the text there is just saying you need to have Dex's link, which we do now. And you do 2 wiggles on that ramp there to get this encounter with a swordy and a fishy. And again, going for the steel wide sword. The steel is important because it area locks the swordy so he can't move. And they only attack if they're in front of you. And we're able to get another double kill and pick up our third dash G. And here we're going to use another Quake to take out this guy with one buster shot. And it gets his long sword. And then just smooth movement there. And another folder edit. This is where we put in all of the mech guards and dash attacks that we've been collecting. Now, we can find out what's causing a problem for the Metro network, and it's Stone Man. So you can see we draw all 3 dash attacks, as well as Mechguard and Gutsman. So this game has what's called program advances, and if you select 3 specific chips in a particular sequence, you can do a program advance. If you take Mechguard, Dash, and Gutsman, basically, Gutsman shows up and throws Mega Man, and deals 500 damage to one target. It's one of the most powerful program advances in the game, and it makes short work of strong bosses, even Stone Man. So now we have access to the Metro line. So we can go to Psylab. Talk to this receptionist here, and she gives us access to our father's lab. Unfortunately, he's not here, in a meeting or something. So, I'm gonna go over here, and we're just gonna leave a message for him. While we're here, we're also gonna pick up a key item, which is at Dad. It'll be a very important item later. Basically serves as an access link to his computer. And now that we've done that, we can go back home for the day. I'm going to read these two emails, and one's from our dad saying, "Sorry I missed you, here have a power-up." That's a fair trade. Those will be important later on. Now we go downstairs to find out that all of the water is out in AC/DC town, which means no breakfast for Lan. So let's go to school and find out what's going on. We just need to go into the classroom and talk to Yai over here. Very short for a fifth grader. Turns out the water's out for the whole city. So Lan, being a very proactive individual, we're gonna head over to the waterworks and see if we can find out what's really going on. This is where we meet one of the other important characters, Chad. He's an official, despite being about the same age as Lan. Which basically just means he's sort of like the net police. So we go borrow our dad's ID, since he's a scientist here at SciLab. It also gives us access to the waterworks, so we're able to get in here and talk to Freud secretly and ask him what he knows about the water situation. He says everything's under control and that we shouldn't worry about it. Sure. But before we leave, we're gonna head into here. Check out the control panel and pick up a couple things. Recov 200. And now, two wiggles here will get us this encounter with the Piranha 2. I'm gonna fire the cannon, move down, throw the quake, fire a buster shot, step back, and fire the cannon. Pretty neat little fight. Those guys have a lot of health, so it took some work to be able to take it out quickly. And we get Trisphere G and go over and pick up 3000 Zenny. Trisphere G is an important chip. We'll be using that quite a lot later. Alright, so we head downstairs. Mega Man says he's suspicious about that Freud guy. So we're gonna go hide out in our dad's lab, wait until everyone leaves so we can go check out the waterworks for ourselves. Some ominous music over here. Alright, now that everyone's left, we're gonna go check out the waterworks. Or wait, not everyone's left. Oh well, I'm sure it was nothing. So now we've got the obligatory ice dungeon, complete with ice physics, cyber ice physics, and we're just going to do some precise sliding over the ice. A little wiggle on the ramp. And this movement is to avoid all random encounters. The gimmick here is, in addition to the ice physics, there's also these water faucets, because this is the water works. Well, I guess the ice works. And sometimes they've got the water turned on, blocking your way. So we're just going to go turn it off. And again, all of these save resets are to manipulate the RNG so that we don't get any random encounters. Or do. And here's Proto Man. Can't have a Mega Man game without Proto Man. But he's being all very suspicious. And not very nice at that. But he leaves for now. So, We're going to turn the water on and then back off. And that'll melt some of the ice that's blocking our path. So we can continue to the next area. I like the music here. It's very chill. We're just gonna slide across this. And pick up M Cannon. Mega Cannon's a pretty good chip. Does 120 damage. Don't actually need it, but there's a library requirement later on, which we'll talk about when that comes up. So we do get one random encounter right here, but we draw the escape chip. In Battle Network 1, they didn't have a run mechanic. Instead, you have to draw the escape battle chip and use it to run from random encounters. Alright, now there's this skip right here. I'm pretty sure I'm one step away from it. That's it. So if you step onto a cutscene trigger and then do a save reset, you can actually skip that cutscene. Skipping a cutscene you think wouldn't matter. Most of the time it doesn't. But there's two places where a cutscene is tied to an encounter. So if you skip the cutscene, you skip the encounter. So we do that trick there to skip a fight against two polar bears, which have a lot of health and take a while to defeat. So we figured we'd fix the waterworks, but for whatever reason, all of the water has been replaced with grape soda. And apparently people aren't happy with that, so I guess we need to go do something about it. Yai sends us an email letting us know that the kid that was missing was Freud's son. Freud's the guy that works at the waterworks. So what happened is the World 3 is blackmailing, well, holding Freud's son hostage and having him corrupt the waterworks. So now that we've rescued his son, we need to go tell Freud to fix the waterworks before people drink too much grape soda. And we're back in Waterworks 1, so it's the same area, and whenever you interact with one of those faucets, it resets your step counter. So then save reset to reset the RNG means we can use the same setup we used last time. Whoops. I held up left instead of up, so I slid the wrong way on the ice. There we go. That's what's supposed to happen. Now we're back in Waterworks 2. Except this time we're gonna go the opposite direction. The last time we went left. There's a key item we picked up, so now we're able to advance to the right. Gotta turn this water off first. Pick up an HP memory. HP memories and power-ups will be useful later. We don't particularly need the health, but it affects our level, which will be a requirement later. But so what's actually happening is Iceman has frozen over a few of the key programs at the waterworks. The first one was preventing water from running, but the second one was the water filtration system. So I call it Grape Soda, but I guess that's just how they wanted to represent unfiltered water. I don't know what this water filtration program is doing, because if the water is that polluted to begin with, that must be one effective filtration program. Because you didn't submit it, Doc. Alright. So, if you slide diagonally over this ice, you can actually skip the first half of the puzzle. So that's pretty neat. We slide right in between two of the gaps. Because there's two of these faucets that you're supposed to turn on, but we only bothered to turn on one. So that saves a good amount of time. And that's the ice puzzle. Pretty neat. Now we're in the final area of the waterworks. Just do some sliding across the ice there. And one final faucet. That blue mystery data there actually isn't on the Japanese version. I'm not sure why in the localization process they added that. Alright, now we save preset in this corner so that when we walk over to Iceman here, we've not done a folder edit since Stone Man, and we actually draw the same chips. So we used Gut Shoot and 2 Dash Attack on Stone Man. Iceman's only got 500 health, so we're able to take him out with just Gut Shoot. He's actually a pretty neat boss fight. He summons three ice cubes on your side of the field and then tries to kick them into you. He also throws a plus shape exploding freeze bomb. And you can get a lot of damage in with your buster on that fight. So, a non-manipulated run of this game. That fight's very different. Alright. And so this is the future of the email. Mail sent is an email. And we're going to respond to it. And now we're gonna go hand deliver the email. Welcome to the future. And there. So now that we've delivered the email, we can go head over to the metro station to meet her there. You get a lot of email in this scenario. There's one, two. Now we have access to Den Town. So we go there. 3, 4. Every time we go to a new area, another email. Alright, so we got another folder edit coming up. First, we're gonna go into this base. So, this base is actually an air filtration system. We're in an antique store, and I guess the air needs to be well filtered so they don't oxidize as quickly. It also has Quake 3 in it, which is a very useful chip. And we're going to put in Quake 3 and Tri-Spear. And now a save reset in another audio cue. We're going to draw Tri-Spear and Gut Shoot. So I said Tri-Spear was a really good chip earlier, and this is our first use of it. Tri-Spear is G-coded, so what I was talking about, Dash and Mech Art earlier, because it's G-coded, we're able to take it with the Gut Shoot program advance, and since Skullman's got 500 health, rather than use both Dash attacks, we can use just the Tri-Spear in addition to Gut Shoot and take him out. Nice thing is, since the Tri-Spear works in 3 volleys of 50 damage, it won't trigger iframes. Whereas if we'd hit him for 100 damage, I think that would trigger iframes. So, here in the city, there's a lot of automatic self-driving cars, and the World 3 has released a virus that has corrupted that, and now cars are crashing into each other. It's a pretty serious situation, and they're selling people an antivirus program for the virus that they created for 1 million zennies. But we can't afford that, so we're just going to go fix the lights ourselves. And now we're going to make use of Quake 3 a lot. It does 150 damage and explodes in a plus shape, so you're able to handle quite a few virus fights using just the Quake 3 chip. And then the Buster Shots are just to advance RNG so that instead of getting Zenny, I get things like Bubbler S. The gimmick for these comps is there's colored floors, the red and the blue, and every time you cross over one of these orbs, it changes. The first one's pretty simple, but some of the later ones are a bit more complicated. So you have to cross over them like multiple times in different directions in order to be able to advance forward. And there, once you get to the end, you're able to change the light to red, stop the cars from running into each other. And then when you go tell these people that you're fixing the problem yourself, they're like, oh, a 10-year-old? Yeah, sure, I trust you. It's funny though, that third person, they don't even have a car or a driver's license. They just got caught up in the moment, wanted to buy it. There we go. So now on to the second situation. So, Miss Mad, who is trying to con people into buying the antivirus, is a little upset. So, she's taken over the bus, and our friend Mail, who's meeting us here, is on that bus. And so she's going to crash it into something or blow up the gas. Forget exactly how they're going to do it. So we have to stop that bus by turning all these lights red that we can before they get to it. So the timing here is a little tight on this one. We have to throw the Quake 3 so that once you get to the version 2 Matars, they go into a defensive state when they're not attacking. And so you have to throw the Quake after the first one attacks, but before the second one attacks. And we're going to pick up another escape chip. So that's the second escape chip that we've collected. There's five you can pick up, but because of RNG manipulation, we really only need two. You can get by with one, but two makes the RNG manipulation easier, because it gives us access to more setups. And then Miss Mad calls us and says, "Sorry, Charlie." Find that amusing? It's a weird cutscene. You can skip it like 2 seconds into it. It's one of only two cutscenes that are like that. I guess three. There's three cutscenes that you can skip halfway through. And we put in the second escape chip, so we move some stuff around because the slots we're going to be drawing are different, so we need to put the chips accordingly. Now, these guys like to jump around randomly, so if I fire one Buster Shot, I can trick them into jumping into the back, so I can take out both of them with Quake 3, and I pick up Quake 2C. I think there's exactly one fight where we're going to use Quake 2C, but it's an important fight, so it saves time. Forever. Here's another encounter. This is with three sorties. I'm going to use Quake 3. Fire two Buster Shots. Throw the Quake. Get hit. and fire the one buster shot. That fight exactly will give us Fire Sword. And then from here, we can walk out of here and should get an encounter. Now, whenever dialogue like that pops up, it's important that you clear it in the same number of frames. So fortunately, if you're holding B, it clears it consistently. So you don't have to worry about it messing up your RNG. Which is one less save and reset we have to do. Because anytime RNG gets thrown off, you have to do a save and reset to fix it. Now the fourth area. This is my least favorite. Just because of the setups that we had to do for it. Routing this particular area took me the longest out of all of the traffic comps. Yes, we got mail from mail. Alright, and here we're gonna use Quake 3, because we picked up Quake 2C earlier, and I talked a little bit about codes and folder flow, so we're gonna pick up Dynawave C. Dynawave C, Quake 2C, and Quake 3C are both very powerful C-coded chips that we can use in conjunction with each other to take out very strong viruses. And we drew the escape chip for this fight because it puts us in a nice corner that we can run down here. And we draw escape here, because this fight should chain into another fight. Right here. And we're gonna draw dash attack and heater. So I've not used heater yet. I've used dash attack before. Boom. Heater is a fun chip. It explodes in 3x3. And it does 70 damage, so heater's a pretty powerful chip, so it's very effective at taking those guys out. That's the fourth one. So we've gotten closer and closer to the bus each time, and now we actually got in front of the bus. So we're going to turn all of these lights to red to trap it. And then we can take out whatever virus is going to cause the van to explode. Well, bus. You get it. Now, the nice thing is each time you interact with one of those color switches, it triggers a cutscene, which resets your step counter to zero. Because it keeps resetting our step counter, we're able to pretty easily get out of here without any random encounters. Your chance of getting an encounter increases every 64 steps, up to a certain cap, usually 50, sometimes 62.5. And having it reset just makes it easier to get out of here without an encounter. And there. With that fourth switch, we've trapped the bus, so now we're able to take out the virus. And this is another audio setup, so I need to listen. That should be it. And we get Tri-Spear and Gut Shoot. So again, Tri-Spear is just doing lots of work here. So I'm gonna fire Tri-Spear. Alright, he moved up. So I move up and hit him with Gut Shoot. He's a pretty annoying boss, Color Man. Because he's got the two dolls in front of him that fire out fire and water attacks, respectively. They're invulnerable, and so they're very... He's a very defensive Navi. makes them difficult to deal with outside of RNG manipulation, which makes them very easy to deal with. And so this is our friend Yai. The whole reason we went to Dentown was to pick a souvenir up for her. Ended up almost dying, but you know, she's very appreciative and gives us 10,000 zenny to show her thanks, so much appreciated, Yai. And for this next scenario, there's some sort of banquet going on at Scilab, so our dad invites ourselves and our mother. We go tell her, and now we're headed over to Scilab to see what's going on. Go talk to this guy, he gives us a little bit of plot, and then we go talk to Chad again. Who, like typical, is a jerk, but it's okay. We don't hold it against him. Here's the banquet. So you gotta talk to everyone. Standard RPG fashion. And of course your dad has to disappear. He's a very busy man. But uh-oh, the power has been turned off. If you look outside the windows here, you can see that we're underwater. I don't know how deep this building is or where they built it, but apparently it's next to some giant lake. And we're deep enough down that once the power goes off, air doesn't circulate very well, so people are concerned about suffocation. So naturally, we go jump down the nearest garbage chute to see if we can get to the generator. I'm gonna make a safety save right here, because this next area is kind of the worst. This is the power plant, and it's the longest set of dungeons, both casually and in the speedrun. And everything is very precise, and you can't leave this area once you get in. So, odds are if you go pick up a used card of this game, there's a pretty good chance that the save is gonna be somewhere in these dungeons. We picked up Red Wave earlier, which I really like the chip. It's effective, it's fast, does lots of damage. But the gimmick for this dungeon is you have to go talk to these Mr. Progs and they give you a set of batteries. And you have to take the batteries to the empty battery boxes, and there's always more boxes than batteries, and you have to figure out which boxes are the correct ones. And the only hint you get is that they're never adjacent. Although you get that hit like 5 times, they want to really make sure you know that they're never adjacent. And I'm actually going to get an encounter right next to this first one, because in order for RNG manipulation to work, you have to be very particular with your step counter. So you have to either pause buffer turns or create corners. Alright. So I did a safety save there, because I need to pause as I'm running by this switch. It's got a hexagon-shaped collision box, so if you slide off of it, that will throw off your step counter. So we need to do a reset to make sure our step counter is preserved. There we go. But well, we got it now.
Hey, Tara.
Hello.
Do you have time for me to read a donation?
I sure do. Go right ahead.
Alright, we got $6 from the Soulful Speedrunner. Mega Man is in this marathon hype, and I'll battle the shirt on networks. I don't know. Also, Kignore. Okay, thanks. Bye.
Alright, then. Thank you for donating. This is a long area. Don't forget to wiggle. It's very important. Whoops. Alright, and here you can see the pause buffer turns coming into play. This allows us to make turns outside of corners while maintaining a particular step counter. It's more difficult than just using corners in other areas, so this is one of the harder places to maintain RNG manipulation. It's not the encounter I'm supposed to be getting. I had to delay. So I think my step counter is one too high. Yeah. Interesting. Alright. Well, we were able to recover. So that's the main thing. Because after this one, we're able to finish off this area. And once we get into the next, it will reset our step counter. I think I know what happened. Alright, so this is Area 3. This is the single longest area in the game. It's because it's got a lot of backtracking with multiple battery boxes. That's, you know, it's kind of a neat puzzle, but it's a bit drawn out with all of the backtracking that you have to do, especially with as frequent as the encounters are. And here we're just going to pick up Remo Bit, another chip for the library. And here we pick up our first three batteries. And we're gonna put one here and here. And we're just making clever usage of corners and pause buffering in order to put them in quickly without messing up our step counter too much. I will say this area has my second favorite track. I hope you enjoy the first 10 seconds of it, because that's about all you get to hear, though. One of the downsides to having to save reset for RNG manipulation. So, in the previous ones we didn't have to collect the batteries, but here we do. Because we need to take the batteries and move them from one set to the next. Alright, here we're going to use Red Wave again. But we're going to throw it so that he gets hit by two of the waves. 200 health is a lot to deal with the chips we have at our disposal. Alright, I'm going to make a safety save right here. Cool. Because you have to pause buffer that turn, and it's a little tight. Not too many pixels. made it to the next area. Or the next section of this area. A safety save right here. Okay, good. Because those switches have hexagonal hitboxes that can be kind of tough to deal with. The first game is definitely a little rough around the edges. It was very much the beta of the series, and the later games refined a whole lot of the features. That said, I do still enjoy Battle Network 1. Yeah. If the combat system is interesting, because really, there's no other game out there that I know of that have anything similar to it, and it's still like one of my favorite games to play casually. I definitely recommend checking these games out. The carts are usually pretty cheap. You can find them used pretty much anywhere. And they're also being re-released on the Wii U Virtual Console, if you'd rather pick them up that way. I'd recommend starting with the third or the sixth. Those are generally the best in the series. Although I would encourage anyone to play through them in order, especially the first three. Alright. Another folder edit there. Fiber. Alright, we're just gonna escape from this. So this is where having chips of the same code comes into play. We're able to use Quake 3C and Dynawave C to deal with an otherwise very dangerous encounter. Mega Cannon, Turn Prog Mark 3, and a Remo Bit is a pretty dangerous combination if you let them go for too long. Fortunately, we're able to delete them very quickly. And we finally have access to the generator. We've made it to the end of the power comps, and now we can find out who's causing trouble and put a stop to it. So, here's Elecman. Unfortunately for us, since the generator's on, he's basically invincible. I literally cannot kill him. Even if he reduces health to zero, he goes back to 600. Alright, one Buster Shot. So there was an audio and a visual cue that you can go off of for this manipulation. We're going to start off using Tri-Sphere. 1, 2, 3, 4. You let Elecman move 4 times, and sometimes you do a Buster Shot, sometimes you don't. It depends on what your chip draw is. You just hold start to skip the cutscene, and not only do we RNG manip Elecman, we also RNG manip against Protoman. Protoman's not too tough of a boss, but he's even easier if you open draw guts. Shoot. Poor guy. It's pretty scary, though. This is, I think, the only back-to-back fight in the game. Protoman's a little upset that you beat Elecman before him, so Chad, being rather bitter, has Protoman attack you. But fortunately, you're able to fend both of them off. So now we're starting essentially the final scenario of the game. Yeah, Gutshoot does 500 damage, which I think is the most damage any Program Advance does, so it's just enough to take out most of these bosses. And if it's not, then we just add in Tri-Spear. So we talked to that guy there, and he tells us that Shad went to Dentown trying to find World 3 operatives to discover the location of the World 3 server. Go back to AC/DC Town after this. I really like some of the tracks in this game. This AC/DC Den Town theme is very relaxing. Another good one is from Battle Network 2, it's Okuden Park. I enjoy just walking through that area. Actually, OC Remix did an album with Capcom, and they did a remix of this called Foreverlasting Peace. I forget what this particular track was called, like Memories of Home, but it's incredibly soothing. Alright, so here's HB. Apparently after his plan to take over the school failed, he decided to open up a chip shop. And everyone is perfectly okay with this. If you turn around when you talk to an NPC, they face the opposite direction, so it's like you're having a secret conversation. But yeah, fortunately for us, he sells some unique chips that are relatively cheap. So we're able to fill out our library using some of the Zenny we collected from all of the navvies we beat. And now we're back in Internet Area 1 again. This is our third time through the area, but it's the final time. There we are. And we're gonna get two encounters, and we're gonna escape from them. I'm going to do a little shopping here. We've been collecting a lot of Zenny, and this is where we're going to spend most of it. We're going to buy a lot of HP memories, a couple power-ups, and a hammer. Leaves us with 12,500. Could have used that to get away. It's a fair point, Ark. And we're going to escape from this as well. And I think we just walk out of here like normal. I gotta admit, after my third time through this area, I might be mixing up what I'm supposed to do. There we go. And now that we're in Internet Area 2, this is where Stone Man was earlier, but we're gonna go a different way this time. And I like this encounter. We need to advance RNG by 4. So we have the Vulgar move twice, each time advances RNG by 1, as well as shooting 2 Buster Shots so we can get the Mind G. And it chains into another fight over here, which is pretty neat. Boom. And again, we're going to use Red Wave and fire 3 Buster Shots. And if you look at Custom, when the bar fills to about the C, I'm going to throw the Red Wave. In the first game, Hardheads didn't have any tell for when they were going to attack, so it was very difficult to hit them. Because they had no warning of when they were attacking, and they were vulnerable for a very short period of time. If you didn't have a cannon or something, difficult to hit. If you tried to hit him with, like, mini bomb, good luck. Fortunately, in the later games, they made it more apparent when they were going to attack. And we chained that actually into the next area into a third fight. Cool. I got the Buster Shot off. I'm always worried I'm gonna miss that. And we pick up Invis 2 here. And now, the neat thing is, whenever you interact with one of these access points, it resets your step counter. So that makes it easy to cut out one of the encounters we got in this area. We used to get 4, now we only get 3. So that saves time. This is the first. And that virus is a Poiton. He drops the dynamite chip. It's supposed to be like a camouflage soldier with a grenade. And they're pretty dangerous. There's one area, the blackboard, and if you encounter a V3 version of that particular virus, it can one-shot you, which is pretty dangerous. And then the handy twos, again, have a lot of health, but because we've got Tri-Spear and Dash Attack, we can take them out without too much difficulty. And so there's a pretty neat fight coming up. We're going to run straight up, and I'm going to hold B because it advances text at a consistent speed, so we're able to start the fight on the same RNG index. So we get Quake 3, 2, and Dynawave. And I'm going to use my movement to time out the first Quake, because again, these guys don't have very good tells of when they're going to attack, and we're able to delete all three of them relatively quickly. So I quite like that fight. And I'm going to do another folder edit. I'm going to read our email. Higsby talks about an old friend. And we're going to save reset. Higsby gave us his memo, which gave us access to this area, which is actually part of the undernet. So we're getting closer to where the World 3 server might be. But we don't have access to go deep enough. So he tells us about a few former associates who may be able to help us get deeper. I just like using heater. And we get Wood Tower C there. And we're just going to run over here and do one more save reset. They, for the internet areas, they only have the one background. And it does get old. Fortunately, the later games have a bit more polish to them. Also, the internet's not a bunch of sticks. As you can see, the pathways are relatively narrow for this area. I would say, definitely, don't judge the series based off the first one. They get significantly better. That's not to say one is bad, it's just a little rough. Right. And we're actually going to carry this manipulation a long way for no encounters. Because when we get to this access point here, and this is where we use @dad, using our father's Twitter handle, we're able to backdoor his computer and use it as an access point to get deeper to the internet later on. And we're going to go do one last bit of shopping, buy wood armor for 15,000, we have 500 zenny left over. I tried so hard to make it exactly zero, but it just didn't work out. Alright, did I talk to this guy? Yeah, I did. Alright. So we're almost ready to get the last two memos. I need to buy a Din Town Pass. Sound like covered with floating ease. Nice one, Method. We picked up Howitzer, which is a pretty difficult to get chip, actually. And this NPC is trying to find one, and he's willing to trade you the even more rare Buster Punch C for it. So we were able to get two chips for the price of one. Good deal. And this is the associate Higsby was telling us about. He gives us lab memo and tells us about two other operatives. Former operatives. So we're going to go see if we can find them. And they're in Din Town. We know where they are, though, so let's go say hi. And buy an ACC pass. Well, to be fair, Six, the E's are rotating, so it's whatever you want them to be. Alright. And so this is summer school. Actually, if you talk to that kid, he's Quiz Kid, and you can get Rattan. So let's talk to her, and excellent, yes. We have 60 chips in our library, so in order to get her memo, the key item we need to advance the game, you have to have 60 unique chips in your library, and most of the route revolves around picking up 60 chips quickly for this requirement. If we were able to skip the memo, the game would look very different. And this is the Blackboard. We do a save reset to guarantee no encounters and go pick up a power-up. And I'm thinking I'm going to put 4 in charge and 1 in rapid. That looks like a pretty effective buster distribution to me. And that brings us to level 30. Combined with the HP memories and the wood armor that we bought, you need to be level 30 to get the second memo. So 60 chips for the library, and then level 30 for the memo. The other one. Buy a government ticket. We buy the tickets early because when you enter the metro, you're closer to the ticket station than if you enter from the top. And get the other memo. Boom. And we buy ACDC. And now we're ready to go deep into the internet, to the far back, where the World 3 server might be. That's a nice email. And here we use a Scilab ID. We're still walking around with our dad's ID, and no one seems to care. And this is where having access to our dad's computer comes in handy. It saves us time. We don't have to go through internet areas 1, 2, and 4 again. Instead, we can just start straight at internet area 9. Cleverly named and all equally distinguishable. Kappa. Alright, now there's a bit of a tight turn up here. Hopefully I get it and don't run into a wall. Excellent. I cut it close. Almost turned too late. So we get out of there with no encounters. And we use the lab memo to access both of these, and now we're in, internet area 6? I've lost count. You do 2 wiggles on the way down the ramp to get this encounter so we draw escape from it. So sometimes, in order to get no encounters, you just have to do like 17 wiggles and a half turn and 3 extra saves, and it's just faster to get an encounter and escape from it. It's also much easier. Consistency is very important to me, so sometimes we find 2 setups and one might be slightly faster, but another will be much easier, and I'll usually go for the easier one. Maybe that makes me lazy. Here we go.
Is now a good time? Oh.
Oh, yeah.
Now a good time to read donation?
Yeah, go for it.
Oh. Okay, we have $15 from Svira. I probably said that wrong.
Svira.
In team, yeah. Well, that's probably a better way to say it. Yeah. In Team BN, members have created the world's first truly meme experience. This is just the first step over the threshold into a brand new era. So don't expect too much. Don't expect a dank, and I think the rest of it cuts off. But yeah.
Nice.
So yeah. Thanks for that.
Much appreciated, Sherwa.
Sherwa. There, that's a better way to say it.
Oh, whoops. I accidentally did a half turn at the end there, so. Lack of focus on my part. Apologies. Minor setback. But yeah. So the movement is very precise. Every time you change direction, that lets RNG advance one additional time. You're supposed to hold left here, and you'll get this encounter. If you turn down too soon, then you won't draw escape, and that's bad. I don't want that. I appreciate the comments. We do 1 wiggle here, and save reset in this corner. Turn up. We're gonna get 2 encounters in this area, and they both have escape in slot 5. On one hand, it's nice to draw a skate, but another consideration is for every additional virus in the fight, for example, this only has one, they each load in individually. So ideally, you'll get an encounter that has one virus and escape in slot one. But that's not always easy to do. So as long as we get a fight that has an escape in it, we'll take it. So this is Bomb Man. He's a pretty neat boss, and we're going to draw five chips on him because he's very difficult. So we need a lot of firepower to take him out. He's got 800 health. We're going to start off with Tri-Sphere. Mash. You want to hit him with two of the Tri-Sphere bolts and then fire off Heater. Heater is very important because it splashes onto Heat Man, or Bomb Man, doing 70 damage, but then fire attacks that hit his bombs will cause them to explode on his area, and if you do that, they'll actually damage him instead of you. So you can turn his own bombs against him, and doing that, we're able to take him down very quickly. So now, suddenly, our dad was behind us the whole time, apparently, and we tell him that, hey, we found the World 3 server address, and he's like, very good. I'm gonna go give this to Chad so he can go take care of it. And we're like, no, you should let us do it. And he says no. And we're like, please? And then he's okay. So a very engaging conversation with our father. Turn around like, how long were you standing there? Oh yeah. So now we're ready to go begin the final day. Especially cheese and cereal. Sounds like Yaru's got a grudge. Oops. I forgot to go pick up the pass. So, you start the day off by heading over to Higsby's, and he's left this weird Metro pass here. It says WWW on it. I'm sure it's not important. We're gonna go talk to the Metro Line people and see if they can figure out where it is. And we're going to buy a Metro ticket here. That kid hanging out outside the Metro line entrance, the orange shirt kid, call him OSG. He's very troll. He spends the entire game trying to get in your way. He's the true final boss. OSG and the menu boss. Got some nice ominous music here. So, apparently there's a secret Metro Line entrance built underneath the school fountain that no one knew about. And so whenever we enter it and try to use Higsby's World 3 Pass, it sets off a very loud alarm. Not sure that was the best installation decision for a secret Metro Line entrance, but alas, we need to figure out how to get by this. Fortunately, we know there's at least one smart NPC in this game, our dad, so we're going to go show him the pass and see if he can reset the expiration date, and what do you know, he can. This raises a few unanswered questions, but we'll leave them for now.
Can I interrupt the soothing commentary for another donation?
Absolutely.
It's from Cheese, Cheese and Cereal. And how do I RNG? This run is too strong. $10. So thank you for that.
Thank you, Cheese. Whoops. I need to buy a Metro ticket. Yes, but actually, I think it was earlier this week, I did a run-through of the current route, and things have pretty much stabilized. So if anyone is interested in this RNG manipulation, it's not too difficult to learn. There is a lot of memorization, but if you would like to run this game, just check out my Twitch channel, and you'll find highlighted two parts of the tutorial. Or you can just send me a PM. I'm always happy to get more people into running Battle Network, because it's a really great series with a very diverse set of... each game has a very different speedrun. If you don't like RNG manipulation, maybe you'd be more interested in Battle Network 6, which is still a lot of execution, but you don't have to save reset every 5 steps. Alright, we're gonna save here. I'm gonna risk it. There's a 25% chance you get an encounter. If you save just in case you get one, but if you don't reset and don't get an encounter, then you save about a second. I've still yet to try cheese and cereal. I'm not convinced, but he insists. Maybe one day. I am not Miss Grand. Alright, again, save reset, only this time there's about a 12% chance to get an encounter instead of 25. How about Wonderswan? No thank you, Doc. A good emulator for Battle Network 6. I recommend Visual Boy Advance for GBA emulation. It works well for me. But yeah, pretty much any GBA emulator will work for it. You recommend any specific cereal? Yes, cheese and cereal. Please go into detail on what combination of cheese and cereal is optimal for eating cheese and cereal. Alright, we got an encounter there, so we don't have to worry about doing a save reset after that fire. Basically, anytime you have to come to a stop, which is interacting with a fire, because of that pause, you need to save reset in order to buffer your movement and continue RNG manipulation. So if you're able to walk through an area without stopping, you can chain the whole area with only one save reset. And so this is sort of like a boss rush. Alright, and we got random numbers again. Second digit too high. Whoa, really? I was hoping for 42. Alright. But we're revisiting each of the dungeons, or like a sort of a new version of each. We did the oven, and now we're doing the school comps again. But I guess they forgot to put bosses at the end of each of these, so... 96. Good number. And we do three wiggles on the ramp on the way up. That's too high. Second digit is too high. 22. Excellent. Alright, fortunately we only have to go through three, and those went fairly well. There we are. The door at the end, though, is a four digit, so it's anywhere between 0 and 9,999. Fortunately, Number Man hops in and guesses it in about 2 seconds, so good on him. Shoutouts to Higsby's hair. And here's the next set. Of course, we have to revisit the... whoops. Waterworks. I swear I was holding up. I guess I was also holding left. There we go. The E-prophecy. Now, this area had a particular challenge when routing it because you need to do a diagonal slide on ice, and it's hard to do that consistently. So what we had to do is find a setup that gets an encounter right there. And what this does is allows us to, upon exiting the encounter, hold right, and we slide at just the right angle to get across this puzzle. Get out of here with only one encounter. Mine as well, Demi. If you're a fan of the Battle Network series and one wasn't your favorite, we do have runs of the other games. You can check out the the Mega Man leaderboards, Joker's website, or search for Team BN. We have a YouTube channel where we upload marathon highlights, or you can just ask us and we'll point you in the right direction. Wait a second. I think I did something wrong. You know what? Let's just fight this. I think it'll be faster than resetting. Oh, that's perfect. Whoops. Never mind, it's not perfect. So this is what fights look like when you don't RNG them in it. I'm just gonna run. I think I did one extra wiggle in there. I'm not sure. That's all good. So this is the final area. If you'll remember, this is the same area that a lot of the cutscenes with Dr. Wily took place. Missed a bomb. I missed more than a bomb there, Doc. My bad. Yes, you get to listen to the battle music for more than 5 seconds. And, of course, we have to revisit the power plant. Fortunately, there's no batteries here. So, it's just a straight shot to the end. Well, straight shot with a few twists and turns and invisible pathways. But, because we know where to go, it's very easy. Just a little improv, Bash. Nothing to worry about. Let me take that corner wide. And here we are. This is the last intentionally manipulated random encounter. You've never finished this game? It's got some parts that are a bit difficult. I did enjoy the story. I may have shed a tear or two at the end. And here's, well, basically the final boss. This is Magic Man. He's very difficult. He can summon 2 of pretty much any virus. He's got 700 health, and he shoots fire down the middle row. Depending on the combination of virus he gives you, this fight can be extremely difficult. Unfortunately, he doesn't have iframes, so he's dead. No, this is Skyrim. And we did it. We beat Magic Man. Unfortunately, plot stuff happens and Mega Man almost gets deleted. But more plot stuff happens and now he's fine again. Oh, is that... Oh, I think I know what image he linked. PNG2, PNG123, what in the world? Alright, so this is the final area. This is leading up to the life virus, which is on the rocket while he's going to launch into space. Now, you can't get random encounters here. Fortunately, I only got one. And I drew escape. It's about as good as it can get. Now, if I can just get this trick here. So, remember that thing we did to the polar bears where we skipped the cutscene and we skipped the fight? Well, we did the same thing to the life virus. So, as fun and cool as the fight is, we did just skip the final boss. By the way, that was time. I should have gave more of a warning. It's okay, though. There were some mistakes in that run, so. I'm gonna guess that was about a 129, maybe even a 130. I did have some sloppy setups in there. Is clearly Fallout. Magic Online. All good guesses. Very accurate. But no, that was Mega Man Battle Network 1. Thank you for all the GGs.
Hi. The restreamer's asleep.
Ah, I see. 132. Alright. I'm not too surprised by that time. A little unfortunate, but the mistakes were my own fault. Because this game is fully RNG manipulated, except for the end there, you can pretty consistently get sub-130. We're still working on improving the route, and I've got a few areas that I need to work on personally, but pretty good, and definitely underestimate. So, thank you, Social Speed.
Well, that was a fantastic run.
I appreciate that.
Alright, up next, Dan Ray is going to be playing Kelowna.
Kelowna was a fun game. Definitely stick around for that.
Hey, Dan Ray.
So, are we good on the schedule? Do you want me to go ahead and end the stream with the credits server?
Yeah, we're good.
Right now,
we can have you switch right on over to Danray.
Alright, so...
So, should I start streaming?
Well...
Let me finish, so... let's see. The game time was 124, so that's not too bad. My PB
nice.
Game time is a 121, and you saw Mega Man appearing in the real world at the end, so that's pretty neat. Thank you guys for watching. This is Mega Man Battle Network 1. If you're a fan of the series, definitely check us out. We do runs of the other games as well, and stay tuned for Klonoa and other great runs here at the Marathon. Take care.